It's a significant escalation in their ongoing battle with the province over wages and working conditions, and they're not the only ones unhappy. This era of austerity, teachers across the country are on a collision course with their provincial governments.
I was sitting in the classroom, trying to look intelligent in case the teacher looked at me. She was long and she was.
Over the course of the past month and a half, we've investigated numerous issues in education, in particular.
And quite effectively, might I say.
And we talked about, the teachers' dispute over the past 11 years with the Liberal government. Mm-hmm. We got to interview Adrian Dix. Mm-hmm. Susan Lambert came and spoke to us.
You went and saw Richard Lee.
Richard Lee. We've talked to a student who was affected by this last year. And we talked to a teacher, my mother, who has been a teacher for over 30 years, who's a teacher librarian in Burnaby, who has strongly been affected by cuts to the education system over the last little bit. What we should do right now is talk a little bit about what are the things that we learned and stuff. But all I think the thing that really struck me was when we first interviewed Adrian Dix, and one of the things that he said was, class size and class composition was this number one issue that teachers had.
I think what happened at the beginning of the decade defined the rest of it. The rest of it is almost like a machine that continues to operate based on what happened at the beginning. In the late 1990s, the government of the day signed an agreement with teachers where teachers essentially gave up salary, in their view, in order to make improvements in what they called classroom ratios, and especially to hire specialty teachers. The agreement itself was controversial within the BC Teachers Federation. The president of the BC Teachers Federation who signed the agreement was defeated, which almost never happens at a subsequent convention. When the Liberals came to office, they had said they wouldn't rip up agreements, and then they did.
Well, as a teacher who's actually working with kids, I think the most important aspect of this job action and the negotiations was how we really protected our kids. Because despite all of the turmoil that was going on in the system, I think for a large part, the children were not really affected. And to me, in education, that's the number one issue.
No, I think that this is an issue, no matter which government we have, NDP, Liberal, or even Social Credit, the teachers' disputes were always there. Fundamentally, I was a little bit disappointed on, even though the issue has been around for a long time, every time there's a negotiation. I was quite disappointed because of the constituents telling me that their children's programs were affected. So for example, extracurriculum activities and sometimes they also referring to the grade 12 exams.
And I think it's a misnomer, or I don't know what the right word would be, but that teachers are not necessarily talking about we want a raise. Yeah, a raise would be great, but the number one issue is we want fair classrooms.
You know, I don't think that people understand the implications of both class size and of class composition. And people always throw the argument with class size, starting with that first, that studies all show that, you know, it doesn't matter what class size you have.
I came into office and talked to people and said, what do we do to improve our schools? And a number of folks said, well, we need smaller classroom sizes. That'll make the biggest difference. And so I gathered information across our state. We had 351 cities and towns. I said, let's compare the average classroom size from each school district with the performance of our students, because we test our kids and we'll see if there's a relationship. And there was not. As a matter of fact, the school district with the smallest classrooms, Cambridge, had students performing in the bottom 10%.
And all I say to people is, you know, if you walked into a room and you had the choice of, you know, going to something that you really wanted to learn about, and you had the choice of walking into a room with 40 people or a room with 20 people, which one would you pick?
Alex Molnar, he's from the University of Colorado, says the reform movement is shoving education toward privatization. Private interests must make the case for larger classes because fewer teachers lowers their expense and maximizes profit.
So we'll talk I want to just mention a little bit about the class size and class composition, which was basically thrown out of the bargaining process in 2002 under Gordon Campbell, and Christy Clark was the education minister at this time. You were part of the caucus, the Liberal caucus at that time. What was your feeling in 2002 when the Liberal government decided that class size and composition could no longer be discussed during the labor negotiations?
I believe that actually class composition and the class size is always a question in those education partners' mind. Is over the last 10 years, I heard discussions. They were not discussed, except probably during the negotiation. That's part of that. They are not discussed. I believe in next year it will be reopened again, so that will be within the negotiation process that will be discussed in the future.
We heard stories of classes around BC where there's, you know, 7 kids in a classroom who are challenged with a variety of things. It might be autism or Down syndrome or whatnot.
I mean, I was in a classroom at Nootka, which is, you know, 18th and Nootka, near Redford Community Center in Vancouver, where there were 8 essentially special needs students, right? Students with in one classroom.
Yeah. Right.
But people were learning in the classroom, was working, and the students were working together, and all the students were doing okay. That's a pretty heroic thing. So that's the first thing to say, that to some degree the system has been insulated against this by really great work by teachers and students and parents and so on.
All of these reforms ignore the context of teaching, the socioeconomic backgrounds of students, class size, class composition, the capacity of the system to provide one-on-one time, and programs individually tailored to students' needs. And instead, this reform movement asserts that only one factor, teacher effectiveness, is relevant. And what worries teachers in BC is that our BC Ed Plan echoes these American reforms in many ways.
I was just really impressed when we were doing this. The first interview, of course, was with Adrian, and we really didn't have an idea what we were doing. And I was asking these questions, and I'm looking on my list and going, I don't really know what I'm going to talk about next. And so I asked you, Eric. I said, Eric, do you have anything else that you would like to ask? And you brought up the FSAs. And it took through our research and interviews that we conducted, it was something that we brought up.
We are in an era when public education is being radically reformed as a private rather than a public enterprise.
Well, the standardized testing, I'm not sure how accurate of a representation it is of how well the students have been educated certain schools, I would think, like private schools, might take them more seriously than the public schools, because it helps get it helps bring people into your school if you're a high-rated school. And maybe the public schools didn't really prep for them at all and just told the students a couple days before that they were going to have them.
I think the model and the way that we assess schools is important. It says what we say, what's important about what we see is important as a society, right? I mean, I've been to some of the schools that finished lowest on the FSA. There's one in Prince Rupert that's been the worst over a number of periods. The Fraser Institute reports. Mm-hmm. Fraser Institute reports, they call them analysis, but really they're not. Mm-hmm. They're kind of Excel programs of FSA data they receive from Victoria. So they get the data and they rank classrooms. And on elementary education, all they're using is the FSA at grade 4, and they're assessing the quality of a school based on that.
We should all be careful and care about our teaching practices and that we're actually being effective. And particularly when we're dealing with all the different changes with technology and all of these, there's a lot of changes in education these days. And we should look at that and evaluate our practices. So I'm not against testing, but I see the damage that it does when you take a school and you list them. And I've been at schools where they have been at the very top of the district. And I've been at schools where they've been at the very bottom of the district, and you see.
You know, it is a social issue. You know, it's this idea of standardized testing.
Well, I'm just wondering. I mean, do we remember taking the FSAs?
I don't remember. I don't personally remember taking FSAs. I remember taking one test in a grade 8 math class that might have been an FSA, but I don't think I realized it.
Okay.
Which was interesting, but I just remember my teacher being really, really, like, worked up about, like, you have to do well on this.
I remember when I did it, I remember it was brutally hard.
Yeah.
Like, I remember it just being hard, and I'm going, well, we never learned any of this stuff. Like, it was algebra, and like, there were more letters in these mathematical questions than there were numbers.
But there are glimmers of hope. Parents are beginning to worry. A study by Ontario's People for Education has revealed a drastic decline in the joy of reading over the past decade. The parents think testing and an overemphasis on the mechanics of reading and the lack of teacher librarians is to blame. They say, quote, if reading scores are going up at the expense of children's acquiring a love of reading, we need to be very concerned. Well, yes.
How long they are willing to have public schools behind picket lines? Because that is one of those issues that might have some really positive consequences in principle. But the act of actually doing it is going to be extremely difficult. And the teachers union takes this one so seriously that we could be behind picket lines for a long time.
The public, the people who had the school, versus all that.
How much was that, though, do you think, that the government was telling the public that that's what the issue was?
Against all odds, and against almost everyone's predictions, including the predictions of some here in this room today, and under Charles Jago's guidance, we reached an agreement with the BCTF that will run to June 30th, 2013.
You don't really want to feel like that is what's
way,
happening.
Yeah,
because
that's true.
That's
yeah.
Propaganda, right?
Yeah. It is exactly propaganda.
Why this issue of teachers and the government is so important. This has been 10 years of fighting at a time when students need the education more. And we've got to stop that. And that's going to require leadership. And we'll see how that goes.
I was sitting